G'day everybody, my name's Callum from DX Commander, and here I am looking at my whisper plots, transmit plots for M0XXT. You can do that as well, just go to whisper.aprsinfo.com and you can see how well it's been performing. But we'll do the whisper plots another day and how well this antenna's been transmitting, because when we launched the Signature 12.4 a couple of weeks ago, I wasn't guaranteeing 30 meters. I said I probably had a trick, and indeed the trick worked out. So let's untangle this and go back to the beginning. So what we've got is about a 12.4 meter pole. So that's 40 something feet, telescopic pole. Now that's supported by three guy wires, and then we've got seven elements, wire elements, starting at the base. So we've got something called a driven plate, supported underneath that by something called a ground plate, and we put our radials on there. And then these seven elements come up. And how does it work? So we've got each element is terminated at a fork connector and goes onto the driven plate. So the center of our coax effectively is going to that driven plate. Now, similar to a fan dipole, a fan vertical, which is kind of how the DX Commander was born, has a number of elements going up. And when our, in the simplest terms, when our wigglies come along flying down the coax, it will see one of the elements as being just the right size for it, and it will go shooting up it. Okay, that's it'll see the right impedance fundamentally. Now, easy so far. So on like a 10 meter pole, 30 something feet pole, it's very easy to get 40, 30, 20, all the way down to 10 meters on six elements. Because the 40 meter element, we can fold over at the top with a little bit of trickery, all right, and we can get 15 meters on that. So six elements will give us all the bands from 40 meters to 10. Now, with a bigger pole, we got an option to get down to 30 meters. Okay, so what we've done is we've put a center element in the middle of the plates, and we helically go up one turn every 6 feet, roughly, to the top of the pole. But fairly near the top of the pole, we've got this coil. And that's what I want to talk about today, because I've done searches on the internet and I can't find anyone that talks about the placement of a coil and the harmonic it gives out. So originally, when we built this pole, we had a coil just over halfway up, and our resonant frequency was fine on 80 meters, but we had this harmonic, which is fine. I was expecting a harmonic somewhere between, I don't know, 10 megahertz and 30 megahertz. I didn't know where the harmonic was going to be. It happened to be 14.6. Now, we had an option then. We could have tuned that coil, but we didn't know how at the time, to force it to deliver a tune at, let's say, 14.2 megahertz. But I didn't know what the losses were going to be and everything else. I wanted to remove the harmonic completely from anywhere near the 20 meter band. And we discovered by moving this coil, I mean, you don't just move it, you have to unwind it all and wind it all back on, by moving the coil up the pole. So what was happening is that the frequency was going down. So we went from 14.6 and we moved the coil a bit and ended up at 12.3. And finally, after a lot of shuffling around, we got it resonant at 10.1. So we've got this 80 meter element, which has got 100 turns at about an inch and a quarter, roughly, at 28 feet, something like that. And that's giving us our next harmonic, which is at on the 30 meter band, 10.1 megahertz, it so happens. So by lifting that up an inch or so, we could have gone down to, from 10, we could have gone to 9.9, 9.8, or by moving the coil down a bit, we could have gone up in frequency. You know, maybe it could have ended up on the 20 meter band. And maybe that's an experiment we do, because what is happening, I think, is that we've now got a loaded 5/8 for the 30 meter band. All right. Now, I know coils typically have a little bit of loss, but that's okay. We often use coils, don't we, in our hobby. They're not terribly lossy, particularly if it's high up the pole. So We've got these aluminium plates at the bottom, and then we've got this, all these spreader plates. Okay, they're made of something called ultra-high molecular weight polyethylene, all right, or UHMWPE, sometimes known as PE, all right. 8 mil, so just over a quarter of an inch thick. They're quite chunky and heavy. Big size of dinner plates, because I wanted to get all the elements away from each other, so the SWR curves really nice. And they are, but that's for another video. The point of this, though, is do you know why moving that coil up and down, the harmonic moves, okay? Now, a lot of people are going to go, oh, I know why that is. It's a trap. You've made a trap. Unfortunately, we haven't. Because when we started this experiment, the 20-meter band, if you had a trap, what would happen is that would need to be about just under 5 meters long, so that when 20 meters, the 14 megahertz frequency comes along, it's a trap. It stops there and it thinks that it's got a quarter wave, all right, and nothing gets through. Unfortunately, that was at nearly 6 meters when we did that, and it was resonant at 14.6. So it's not a trap, it's definitely just a harmonic, and I think it's sort of 5/8. And there we are. So it all works. We launched on, I think, a Saturday morning. By Sunday night, we had sold the first 50 on a special deal. That was at 359 or 369, I can't remember. We're still on the deal at 399, so you can now have the confidence, all right, to build one of these and take one home with you. So I've currently got this on a hinge, but I've worked out a procedure where you don't need a hinge. I mean, I've got one because I want to put a lot of different poles up and down all the time. So I've got this hinge, right? But you, to invest in a hinge, I just think is a bit of an ask. You know, it's another $50, $60 or $100 or something. Well, you just don't need that. So I've worked out a procedure which I'm putting in the user guide, which means you don't need a hinge. You'll just be able to lift it up and down using some short guys, about that long, into the ground, so the pole doesn't go anywhere as you lift it up. So don't worry about spending money on hinges, all right? If you really want a hinge, go and get one, but you don't need one. What you do need, though, is enough room. When you drop this over, you're going to need at least 40 feet, 12 meters and a bit more, so the thing can lie down. So just be careful about power lines, people, pets and things like that. I've currently got this on 3 guys. Okay, and only 3, and I will find a clip that's on my Instagram feed of when we got hit by, I think it was 48 or 49 mile an hour gust for a few seconds. And if it went S-shaped, certainly, but it went fine. If you want to storm protect this, you're going to have to guide it, the one down from where I guide it and the one up from where I guide it, because I have left specific holes in the guy plates and the UHMWPE stuff for guys. But I'm particularly myself, I'm happy with just the 3 guys. Remember, that is a single point of failure, so do go out every month or so and just check they're not fraying. The only thing we don't supply is your radio, your coax and the guy stakes. Okay, so you're gonna have to go and play guy stakes. And I do that because some people want a concrete block with a bolt in it. Other people want to hammer a, like a scaffolding pole in the ground. You could take a 10-foot piece of scaffolding, put it in a couple of feet, so the scaffolding comes up, you know, waist height, and put an eye bolt there. And you get your lawnmower underneath your guy wires, things like that. And also, you remember back in the day, I tried to self-support this with an aluminium pole. Long story, it didn't work out. In fact, we were sinking a lot of our RF straight into the ground. It was acting as a big capacitor. People are going, oh, could you use plastic, fiberglass? You can use all sorts, I'm sure. Bear in mind, right at the base of that antenna will be some bolts to hold this thing in place, and you will just crush whatever's there unless it's metal. All right. Personally, I think this is a guide system. I wouldn't go unguide. Once you start seeing 30 mile an hour wind, 50 mile an hour gusts, you'll believe me. You'll go, oh my goodness, what have I done? All right, so there we are, 80 through to 10, no ATU required. We're going to do SWR curves another day, but it will do 6 meters with a nudge, just a nudge of the ATU. All right, you can buy it from my shop. All right, this isn't a sales pitch, by the way. I might as well tell you where you can get one from, because I'm very interested in this coil. I think this is fantastic that we could do, for instance, a fan dipole. You could have 80 and 30, if you think about this, on the same element by just putting this coil in exactly the right place. Then you could have 80, 30 or 40. We could be moving this coil and get it to 40 on a harmonic, and 18, 40 and one element. What a great experiment that would be, all right? And then another one for maybe 30. You could do 30 and 20 on one element. So we need to work on that this year and just understand what's happening and how that's working. Okay, so we'll do the plots in the next few days. We'll do the SWR curves, or you can stay ahead of all this. Go to my Instagram page, DX Commander. All right, because I publish all this on the fly. Oh, they'll like this. You know, sometimes I just want to, you know, upload stuff. I'm not a big Instagrammer, but if you want to stay ahead of the curve, go to Instagram. All right. That's it for the time being. Sorry, I haven't been around. I have just been absolutely flat out. Mike, M0MSN, said, I know you've been flat out because you phone me on Saturdays and you phone me on Sundays from the antenna field. Poor Mike's had it in the neck about this coil. Adios. See you next time. All right. Bye for now.